Next will be Barrister Natasha Hadiza Akpoti.
I'll go to C, 2C, which states that the economic system is not, that the economic system is not operated in such a manner. That means the government is going to ensure that the economic system is not operated in such a manner as to permit the concentration of wealth or the means of production and exchange in the hands of few individuals or a group of people. A body shall be set up by the act of the National Assembly, which shall have power to review from time to time the ownership and control of business enterprises operating in Nigeria and make recommendations to the President on the same. That means what is going on here, the debate that we hold so preciously, is actually in line with the functions of this honorable house. So the people of Nigeria will be our nation to help us. And we hope that In my hands, I also have the
formal... Zakari Mohammed, please.
The out-of-court settlement brought about the reconcession agreement. And the terms of the reconcession agreement stated that Itakpe should be given back to Global Infrastructure Nigeria Limited, because Nigeria owes Global Infrastructure Nigeria Limited $525 million. If you recall, the Minister, Honorable Kayode Fayemi, said several times that it was the court in London that actually told us to pay that amount, and Nigeria does not have $525 million. Therefore, the only option we have is to give it back to them to complete their 8 years. To complete the 10 years since they have done 3 years. Permit me, I would like to read from the letter, the memo the Attorney General Advocate wrote to President Jonathan on the 12th of December, duly signed by his signature after each page attested. Item 6A. In light of the fact that a presidential committee had estimated damages, please, I'm going to go through this again because it's very important. Item 6A reads, in light of the fact that a presidential committee had estimated damages payable to Global in the region of $525 million, the agreement of Global to waive its right to damage is a substantial achievement. This shows you that there was a presidential committee that was hooked up, put together, people of like mind promoting a particular interest. And it was that committee that actually indicted Nigeria to the amount of $525 million. It is not the courts, it was the committee. And I do have a list of the members of the committee, which I can share with you later. I would just say that it was headed by the Vice President, Sambo. Is not bided by such a decision of a committee. And I would like this Honorable Court to demand the host, sorry, forgive me, be interesting to know the parameters in which they arrived at such a decision. Knowing full well that there was also the Inwamagaji report, which clearly itemized the damage, and even the monies borrowed from CBN without being paid, and proof that there was no money that was brought into Nigeria. So we begin to understand, imagine $525 million. So going by this, it will not be wrong to say that the agreement which was entered in the office of the Vice President Osibanjo on the 1st of August 2016 is null and void, because in law you cannot give what you don't have and you cannot take what is not yours. So by this, Nigeria does not owe global infrastructure $525 million, and so they have no right to spend a day in Nyong'o. Furthermore, I would like to state that right here in my hands, I have before me, this is the reconcession agreement that Advocate tried to have effected before the termination of the Lord Jonathan's administration. And here in my left hand, I have the reconcession agreement finally entered in August 1st. It will interest you to know that the two agreements are the same. When I read both, errors, even the typographical errors, contained in Advocate's concession agreement are also contained. There are over 25 of them. So you begin to wonder, did he review this agreement, or it is the same agreement that later Edward terminated, which he said was grossly shrewd against the interest of Nigeria? So it's left for this court, this house, to decide. Mr. Speaker, I'd like to say that it's such a great honor to know that for once I have seen someone in authority whose ideas resonate with mine and the good people of Nigeria. We are against the privatization or concession or whatever it is called. Ajaokuta is too important to be in the hands of an individual left alone in a foreign country. A company that has the capacity of manufacturing weapons should not be held in the hands of anybody. I mean, considering the fact that we tend to focus more on our diversity here, what would it be in the hands of an Ibira or an Igbo man or a Hausa? It should be a property of the Nigerian, of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, sir. So, and I will tell you that the idea of privatization tends to create a lot of green-eyed monsters. The idea that somebody can own such a magnificent structure creates such uncontrollable greed. And I will speak about this. Sometime last year, it got to my findings that a particular company was registered to acquire Ajaokuta. It's called Ajaokuta Cooking Nigeria Limited. I have before me the papers that prove that this company was authorized, the registration of this company was authorized by the governor of Kogi State, Alhaji Yahaya Bello, in partnership with Global Infrastructure Nigeria Limited, the same people. Now they have gotten it into their hands, and the next target was to acquire Ajaokuta at all costs. So they devised the case. And going by the certified true copy of the form CAC7, a company that is supposed to carry the front and the interest of the people of Kogi State, it's a federal asset, but supposing the Federal Republic of Nigeria has given Kogi State the mandate to proceed with ownership, resuscitation, and operations of Ajaokuta, you will all assume that Kogi State should be a major shareholder, isn't it? But what I have here, the two directors of this company, one, Onoche Ikechukwu, who's from Benue State, and Aichaba Emmanuel from the eastern part of Nigeria. And both of them, it will interest you, are affiliates, staff of Global Infrastructure Nigeria Limited. Both of them share no other director in here. This is a shell company, sir. If it had succeeded, do you mind looking at this? If it had gone through, we would have, on the face of it, assumed that Ajaokuta was then already in possession of Kogi State, probably working for the good people of Kogi State and Nigeria, when in reality, it's just a company that is owned by two people who are promoting vested interests. So we wrote a petition. On the 3rd of July, we wrote a petition to the Registrar General of CAC. And he was very shocked. I wouldn't bore you with the happenings there, but he was very shocked. And he ordered a committee, to the best of his knowledge, the files before him did not contain that the company was registered. He knew it was registered already months before that. So I will see this first letter stating that the file had been quarantined and a committee was set up and they were going to investigate. May I read the first line? From our investigation, it was discovered that the above-named company, which was meant to be registered as a special purpose vehicle by the Kogi State government for the concession of Ajaokuta Steel Company, does not capture the legal representation of Kogi State. This has therefore defeated the essence of giving consent to the registration of Ajaokuta Kogi Nigeria Limited as a special purpose vehicle of the Kogi State government. But I was surprised again a few months after when I received another letter from this same Corporate Affairs Commission. By then, the gentleman, the Registrar General, had retired, and there was an actor who is still acting now, the lady I told. And he told me, the letter reads, that they have allowed the company to proceed. CAC does not have the right to regularize an illegality. In bad way by their act, if there is a fraud committed upon registration and the content or the context in which a company is registered, it should go for the registration. And then if the company wants to proceed, they have to apply again. When I spoke with a few people at CAC, I was told there were orders from above. I said, who? They said, the Kogi State Governor sent the commissioner, Idris Siwaju, and there were pressures from the presidency. I would like to state that I believe President Buhari will not sanction this, but there are many people who lie in the president's name. Finally, I'm going to the conclusions. Finally, dear Honorable House, if the Minister of Finance were to be here, we would have posed a very important question to her along the lines and reasoning of the Speaker. How can we say that Nigeria does not have the financing capabilities to revive Ajaokuta? No, it's not true. We do have the funds. But I will tell you the easiest of all. Many of us have heard about the natural route, but few of us have actually bothered to find out what amounts to the Abacha route. I would read a report from a United Nations report. A United Nations report put forward in 1998, and it states, in another stunning disclosure, a government spokesman said in December that the administration was investigating an alleged $2 billion fraud by some members of the previous regime. They were careful in mentioning the previous regime. This involved the withdrawal in 1996 of $2.5 billion of public owed to Russia for the construction of the Ajaokuta Steel plant, but which in reality have been discounted to only $500 million. Let me explain that. In a secretly negotiated debt buyback deal, local and foreign media reports have speculated that General Abacha may have more than $3 billion stashed away in overseas bank. This was in 1996. May I talk about debt buyback? By the time the Russians left, in 1994, Nigeria was owing them close to $1 billion, because long before the change in administration actually affected the funding. It would also interest this house to know that 3 years before TPE, which is the original builders, left the country, every month for 3 years they were writing memos to the Ministry of Mines and Steel, or however it was called then. Not one letter was responded. 3 years. From 1991 to 1994, there was a status report telling them that, look, we are nearly completing the plant, but we cannot complete the 2% because we need the infrastructure set up. Because once the 2%, which is likely the blast furnace, once it's ignited, the blast furnace is to run for 80 or 25 years non-stop. That means many people say, why did the Russians really wanted Ajaokuta to work? Why did they need 2% at 90%? It's because if they had started, we have had a lot of some damage. And for these 3 years, which was more than enough that you have the infrastructure running, the roads, dredging. At that time, they even proposed the dredging of River Niger. But not one letter was responded to, and they had to leave. It was a sad experience, they had to leave. It was more sad because, like I said, people like me, many Russians that came to Nigeria and got married to Nigerians, they had to, they were separated. My mother till today does not even have a Nigerian passport. My father wasn't working for the public. Those were not separated. So when they left, I will read now. In October, okay, when the Russians left, and we had such huge debt to pay, they did not take Nigeria to court. They kept us sending letters to the line. How are you going to pay this? But most importantly, they reminded Nigeria, if you are interested in this, continuing the completion of your plans, let us know. We will come back. All we have to do is negotiate. But what happened was, in October 1995, I'm going to read from this part because there are some key words I don't want to miss. Series of debt buyback transactions took place, whereby the debt instruments were sold at inflated prices to Liberian companies purportedly owned by the Abachas. The two companies are called Parma Shipping Corporation and Mecosta Securities. These are two companies that were registered in Liberia, and these are the two companies that bought the debts. Now, on one part, Parma Shipping Corporation and Mecosta Securities, on one part, they were negotiating the reduction of that near $1 billion debt. And Russia waived away over $400 million. I said, you know what? A struggling country, a small country, just paid $500 million. Forget about the rest. While on the other hand, the Abacha administration told Nigeria that the Russians insisted on the money on the near $1 billion, and apart from that, they were debt incurred upon the debt buyback. So that amounted to $2.5 billion. So that means $2.5 billion were taken from our reserve, but only $500 million was paid. So that is the debt buyback. So it's not wrong to say any Abacha loan that is left in the banks of Switzerland and other banks can actually be pulled together to be by Ajaokuta. On the other hand, if such monies are not enough, I can say with my interactions with other Nigerians, Nigerians are ready to crowdfund that project. Mr. Speaker, just 2 years ago, or United for the Responses of the Union. 2014. The Egyptian government embarked upon a huge project to dualize the Suez Canal. And that Suez Canal, the President Sisi sold the idea so patriotically to the people that $8 billion was raised in 10 days. Mr. Speaker, this is a fact. $8 billion was raised in 10 days from a country that has a population of just 91 million. They don't have individuals as rich as Nigeria. But what matters is leadership and the ability to connect to the people so that an average person on the street, the person roasting corn, the organizer, everybody will believe in this national dream and vision and know that they are one penny. Just like the movement that brought in our beloved President Buhari, that movement, we can make it happen to Nigeria. But we must be patriotic enough and be able to present to the people accountability, transparency, inclusiveness, and an untampered world. Nigerians can make the money. I can put my effort into it. So I'm going to read the conclusions we have put. That one, this Honorable House considers that the Neon Coast reconcession of August 1st to Global Infrastructure Nigeria Limited, or Global Steel Holdings, and however they are called, be terminated with immediate effect.
Order. Order, please. Order, please.
That EFCC must be called to conclude the prosecution of Global Infrastructure Nigeria Limited for the economic crimes, according to orders of late Yaradua. May I read the publication here of 3rd of April 2008. President Umaru Musa Yaradua also ordered the arrest and prosecution of all government officials and promoters of Global Infrastructure Nigeria Limited indicted of asset seizure in the Economic and Financial Crimes Commission. May I tell you, sir, that last year, in February of last year, we wrote to EFCC to reopen the file. We wrote several times. We are actually in court with them, seeking an order of mandamus which will compel the EFCC to either reopen the case or to hand over the file to us, and we will pool a team of patriotic lawyers and get this justice for the people of Nigeria. So, sir, there's a pending case there because we believe that a crime against Ajaokuta is a crime against Nigeria, and there is no court. Supposing this $525 million was actually an order of the greatest court on earth. Nigeria is a sovereign nation, and we decide to allow criminals or not to allow. That's appalling. So, sir, it's actually Nigeria's duty to ensure that people who have committed crimes on this land are not holding our most precious assets. Also, we say that Ajaokuta and Itape must not be privatized or possession, but be owned 100% by the federal government of Nigeria and operated alongside the original builders only in areas of technical expertise. And once there is an absolute transfer of technology, the Russians can go. Believe we have seen Nigerians around the world conducting amazing things in engineering, so there's no reason why they shouldn't. We would also like to appeal that this Honorable House asks to get the executive to assemble a team of economic experts to travel to Russia, which I'm speaking with regards to the bilateral agreement which is still standing open. Because we believe that once a country or two countries come together and agree on a particular reasoning, then that is binding on the nations. It's upon the meeting with President Putin that Nigeria can then begin to decide the way forward. And I also agree with the previous speakers that there has to be a redesign of the steel sector. Why a redesign? It's because when I visited Russia 2 years ago and I spoke with the original builders, they told me that the plan upon which the Nigeria steel industry is built, it was designed in 1971 by the geological survey conducted by these same original builders. And they said by now, the advancement of technologies and innovation in the sector has caused the realization and usage of new materials which were ordinarily not known to them then. They also told me that we might be oblivious of the fact that Rolls-Royce today, the great Rolls-Royce, uses important alloys sourced from Kogi State, probably supplied by illegal miners. But that is why I say it is very important that we call them back to conduct another survey, because probably in the modernization and upgrade of the plant, there could be new sectors that are injected so that new minerals can be incorporated. Thank you. And by and large, that is what we have. I've come to an end of this presentation. And I would say again that I know many will talk about why am I promoting Russia? Why am I not promoting China and India? With due respect to every country's steel capacity.
Barrister Natasha, having heard you now, I thought I knew the direction that this debate will take. I'm more confused than ever before.